So, thanks very much for the introduction. It's a great honor for me to stand here today in front of you as a newly appointed professor for the design of structures, a joint position between the Department of Architecture and the Department of Civil and Structural Engineering. My position is at a threshold between two disciplines, and over the next 20 minutes, I will try to give you some idea about the questions and topics I've been working on over the past few years and possible directions for future research. Like often in life, there are some kind of defining moments that hit you unexpected, and only in retrospective, the importance of these moments gets clearer to you. Without knowing at that time, my research started in about 1995 when I took part in an archaeological excavation in Kinneret at the northwestern shore of the Sea of Galilee. In its heyday, in the early Iron Age, that is about 11th century to 10th century BC, Kinneret developed into a regional center, controlling the surrounding region and becoming one of the most important urban sites of the country. Because of this, Kinneret is one of the key sites for the debate on the history and development of ancient Palestine. I don't know if you ever had a chance to work on an excavation site. It's not so romantic as it might sound. Yeah. Most time it's very hard work, digging by hand and removing kind of carefully layer by layer. The result of this endeavor, you can see here, the plan of an ancient city of Kinneret that surfaced after removing several meters of earth. Of course, this image that you can see here doesn't show reality, but is already an abstraction of the real situation, or how we would say it today, maybe in a more modern term, the result of data cleansing. The real situation on the excavation site looks different. It's much more, how you say, less defined, more chaotic, yeah, much vaguer. Hence, working on an excavation site, you constantly facing one simple question. Yeah, at which point is a stone only a stone, or already part of a wall? At which point is a change in the consistency of the earth, not only natural fluctuation, but tamped ground? Yeah, at first, this seems to be a kind of silly, childish question. But once you start to think about it, you realize that it touches upon fundamental questions, like, for example, where does order come from? What is order, actually? And how do we recognize it? Yeah, clearly, I'm not the first one who is coming up with such questions. In philosophy, they are kind of something like the daily business. And yeah, don't worry, I'm not going to, you know, to a long exegesis on kind of the various philosophical positions on the notion of order in nature. But what I would like to point out is the fact that contemporary philosophy came to the same conclusion as, for example, psychologists. Order in nature is not only based on the laws of physics, but also very much the result of perception as an active act of filtering and structuring sensorial information that is of the human capacity of constantly organizing and structuring perceived information for the sake of orientation. Yeah, something we have just heard before already. It is this ability to detect regularities and to extract patterns that in antique Greece was called ta mathemata, which means what can be learned, or in the opposite way, at the same time, what can be taught. Mathematics, where of course is kind of related to the word ta mathemata. So mathematics as a discipline is not so much a technical tool for precise description and forecasting, but rather a way of thinking in structures and organizational pattern. And maybe most important, mathematics is not about absolute truth, but rather a man-made construct that helps us as humans to formulate and discuss ordering principles and visit the possibility to order and organize the world in which we are living, ordering mentally but also physically. And this characterization is true for architecture too. Architecture is a man-made construct and a form of expression of order and organization of our Lebenswelt, as the Edmund Husserl called it, so of our mental and physical being in the world. Yeah, with this in mind, the question of order and organization in architecture has to be seen as a mathematical one, as a question of ta mathemata, as I called it. Yeah. With the mathematical as a way to understand the interaction of form and matter in the physical world, and at the same time, a means of human expression. And it's in this field between the necessity of physics and the freedom of design that mathematics function as a kind of mediator. And it's through the organization of form and matter within architecture that we are getting aware of other type of patterns of organization, like social patterns, political or cultural relationships that frame human life. Hence, if I have to describe in kind of very briefly in my research interest, then maybe a good way to describe it is an attempt to in some way unleash the design potential within scientific and engineering knowledge. So what I'm exploring are methods and design techniques to bridge between the technical and the artistic by means of formal design strategies. And it's this cloud of topics and relationships that you can see here that somewhat denotes the notion of hylomorphic structuralism and forms the basic conceptual framework of my research. In order to go into depth and explore more detail the design space offered by the necessity of physics, the problem of structural stability was chosen as a kind of basic case study. So the reason for this is simply that structural stability is one of the most fundamental requirements for physical beings to exist. It's simply an essential property. Contrary to science or engineering, the goal of my research is not to understand and be able to predict every small phenomena in the interplay of form and matter, but rather to get a kind of principal understanding that could be used in an early conceptual design stage or in the early stage of design processes. So what I'm in some way aiming is something like an operative diagram. That's why my research is focused on understanding of basic geometric logic of the inner force flow. That means the simple geometric rules that govern the interplay between tension and compression within a material system. Out of this, a working method that's called graphic statics has been developed that reveals some kind of a reciprocal relationship between form and force flow. And this then can be used within a simple design exploration, like for example here in this small office table that's based on operation of folding. What is important here is to recognize that the graphic method is not imprecise, but it reduces the amount of structural information to a minimum. As a consequence, the graphical method does not overload the designer with too much information, but rather provides something like a simple rule or a set of rules that can be combined in infinite many ways, similar like, for example, following the rules in a game of chess or something like this. Now, this approach has resulted in a design-oriented understanding of structural thinking that uses structural elements and principles as an expressive element, like in this design for a conference table that has its origin in the idea of kind of creating a table as a flying horizontal plate. Yeah, or in this design of a screen where the structural understanding of the material was used to manipulate the form of the screen according to special, specific spatial requirements and at the same time as a control parameter for the amount of light that filters through the screen. In the design of the stage for the Malta Design Week, the understanding of force flow that we gained from exploring reciprocal structures was used to explore the emergent structural capacity in a construction based on a large number of very soft and weak elements. Structurally, this design functions similar to a woven structure, like a bird's nest, through collaboration of all members in a non-hierarchical manner. I think what all these different design projects have in common is that the driving force in the research over the years was not only in some way to make, call it a structure in artistic use of structures, but use structural ideas also in some way to gain multiple functions out of it. So use structures, for example, not only for space making, but for shading, thermal control, ventilation, or other type of performative requirements. That is, the research is always aiming at an exploration of the structure at what I call polyvalent material systems. For this, the accumulation behavior of material systems has been studied within a design research approach with the goal to achieve the ability to direct the growth of these kind of patterns of systems. Yeah, this was done through the formal exploration of the parametric variability of basic elements and its tectonic logic, resulting in a fully digital description of the internal logic of the basic elements and its accumulative potentials. Yeah, of course, this is all very fundamental research and has not reached building scale yet. But several design studies have been conducted and various proposals were exhibited prominently, like in London, the Architectural Association, or at the Biennale in Venice. Yeah, it's clear that in this short time I have here for this lecture, I cannot describe in detail the underlying formal techniques and methods of designing that have been developed over the past few years. But what I would like to stress is the emergence of a systemic thinking that results out of these various design approaches that start to replace the traditional process of working within architectural design, and which is often much more linear and hierarchical. This paradigmatic change will not only lead to a radical change in the communication and collaboration between disciplines of architecture and engineering, but it also has the potential to change the building industry as we know it today. Two possible directions of change I would like to mention briefly, just to give you an example. I think the first major shift, I believe, will be the move away from an adding on of more and more monofunctional layers, like it's typical for a wall construction we know today. This kind of construction will come to an end due to the difficulties in assembly, the complexity of the details, and its susceptibility to errors. Future constructions will be based on differentiated material systems with polyvalent behavior, like in the example you can see here, like bamboo, where through the variation of size, density, or relative location of cells, various functions like structural stability and the ability to transport fluids and nutritions are provided. Such systems depend only on one material instead of a sequence, a layering of materials, which enables much more efficient production. Of course, production and even assembly of such material systems will be done by CNC machines and robots, which also will increase precision and reliability of the assembly. I know this sounds a little bit like science fiction, but it's already happening today in many of the research labs around the world. So what I'm talking about still requires a lot of research on all levels, but the tendency is clear, it will come. A second major shift is based on the possibility to redirect forces in space, which is kind of the basic of design freedom. This redirection of forces causes an accumulation of forces within the area of redirection, as you can see here. And this accumulation can be read as a kind of quasi-turbulent pattern of energy dissipation. Now, the same phenomenology happens in other types of flow, like the wind pattern around the obstacle, like a house or a wall, for example. Now, this similarity in the flow pattern points to an underlying principle that governs the flow of energy in space in general. I am aware that this is highly speculative, at the moment at least, but there are indications that such a shift in perspective from, let's say, force flow to energy flow is going to happen, and this probably will cause a reorganization of the whole engineering discipline. Now, from a design perspective, this similarity in the flow pattern between inner forces and wind, for example, opens up new possibilities for design, sustainable design that has been already tested in, for example, in a redevelopment project for a courtyard in Athens. And in order to activate a courtyard in summer, the idea was that wind should be used for cooling. Yeah? And to achieve this, it's proposed to kind of redirect the prevailing wind into the courtyard. And the concept for this redirection is based on kind of similar types of redirection within the inner force flow around a hole within a plate. Yeah, and this concept was used to propose a series of fins that redirect and compress the wind. At the same time, the fins grow in size to be used as benches or the three biggest ones, even as spaces for a kindergarten and a bistro. Simulations of the wind flow has proven that this is a valid concept, and it shows that the methods and techniques for the control of force flow have the potential to guide the design of other types of energy flows. Again, of course, much research is still needed to understand better the reason for the phenomenological similarities and its limitations. But already the design example shows that such an holistic understanding of principles of energy flows can fundamentally change our perception of sustainable design. A sustainable built environment cannot be achieved primarily by technological improvement, but it requires more intelligence within the design process. With this area, we can find the greatest, within this area of kind of improved design, we can find the greatest potential for energy savings. Design thinking does not only produce an aesthetic value, but it is an essential factor in the production of a sustainable environment. And this is maybe the most kind of surprising implication of my research. Design really matters. It's really important and essential. And I think with this kind of nice message, I'd like to conclude my lecture. I hope I was able to give you a kind of a brief overview of the kind of research I'm interested in and the relevance and possible implications for the future. Thanks very much.